It is illegal to recite or to have a copy of the Quran in your home. It is illegal to dress as a Muslim. They go through Ramadan every year with these kind of challenges. And so we are grateful that we are here on that day. We could have also been in Greenland and Denmark and Norway and Finland, in which they fast 20 hours a day. And they have 4 hours to break fast, to make maghrib, to make isha, to do tarawih, to eat for suhoor for the next day, and then make fajr. They have 4 hours to do all of that, and then they fast 20 hours. We could have been there, so we are grateful for that. We are grateful that we could have been in a place like Syria, or Palestine, or Iraq, or Burma. But we are here. And so I want us to understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us to be in this moment of time. And so because of that, when we approach Ramadan and what is happening in this month, do not adopt the traditional way that most Muslims do, and that is the minimalist approach. That we will do as least as possible in Ramadan just to get by. Ramadan presents to us a spiritual buffet of choices. I know one of the most exciting things we do is when we go to a buffet. But imagine a buffet in which all the food is amazing. What do you do when you go to a buffet where everything is healthy? The first thing you do is you are grateful to be present at that buffet, to have an opportunity to partake of it. The second thing you do is you said, you know what, this might be the last buffet that I will ever come. And you never get a chance like this again. And the third thing is you take as much as possible to enjoy and benefit from that buffet choice. It's like having a sale. You don't go to a sale and sell and buy the least amount of stuff. You ever see a sister shop at a sale? One car is not enough. It is when the opportunity arrives, you seize the moment. So I want the believers here today to approach Ramadan with a point of view that I will take as much of the choices that Allah has given me this month and not be minimalist and do the bare minimum just to get by. There's an English saying which says, make hay while the sun shines. And among these choices that Allah has given us, one of it is, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu kutiba alaykum. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that He wants us to fast. And He gives us the reason right after. Because when you fast, it is a way, it is a doorway for you to get something called taqwa. Taqwa comes from the root wikaya, which means to protect. When a person has taqwa, they develop the amazing ability to protect themselves from the things which Allah does not want you to do. And how does fasting bring taqwa? What Allah does with fasting is He takes two of your most powerful emotions, your sexual urge and your urge to eat. Obesity is one of the biggest problems in America. This urge to eat is so overpowering that we can't help ourselves. Everything is supersized. You go to McDonald's, supersize. And the sexual urge, we look at all the scandals, and you can see no matter how powerful the person is, they find it unable to restrain themselves. And so Allah said, these two most powerful emotions, I want to teach you how to be strong and to control them only for Allah. And so Allah in Ramadan tells you, I don't want you to eat, and I don't want you to have any kind of sexual relations during the daylight hours. And do it only for my pleasure. And so the person who decides to take this program is now finding that it is a difficult thing. Training programs are difficult. You go in the army, they put you through a lot of stuff because when you finish, everything has become easy. When the training was so tough, all the other regular stuff becomes easy. When you do this training program or that, the rest of the year, it's very easy to be able to not go towards it. So Allah says, I want you to do this only for me, so that you may get this special quality. But I'm going to sweeten the pot for you. If you fast and you partake in this program, then I'm going to make a special gate in paradise for you. Called Al-Rayyan. Only if you do fast will go through this. face 70 years of little fire. I will cause blessing in the food you eat in the morning. I will cause when you break your fast at night to experience one of the two greatest joys of a human being can. I will make this fast go on the day of judgment and intercede on your behalf, saying, oh Allah, I kept him and her away from food and drink. Give them paradise and the result. Allah is providing incentives for us to fast. Many, many rewards. من صام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. He who fasts in Ramadan with Iman, hoping for the mercy of Allah, Allah shall forgive you your sins. And so all of this is linked and connected. He says, I will reward that fasting. I will take care of it. Other kinds of deeds, you have standard rewards for them. But this one, I will personally compensate you. It's like the big boss saying, for this project, I am going to reward you personally. You're not going to follow the standard 10% that the company gives. We're going to give you, I am going to make sure that you are well taken care of. And so Allah wants us. And so you have this choice. And so each of us must make a decision that in Ramadan, stop making excuses. My toe is hurting. How does that affect your fast? But that's called technically I'm sick. And according to the Sharia, sickness means you don't have to fast. The sickness doesn't affect the fast. But you make a quick excuse to say, okay, I'm going to take a concession. Don't do that. Engage with this opportunity. If you have not fasted yet, if you have never fasted before, make a decision. And I deal with a lot of new Muslims. One of them is fasting this year for the first time. I know what he's worried about. He says, that morning coffee, oh, I gotta have it. You know, and I don't know if I'll be able to survive the month. He's not worried about the rest of the day. He's just worried about, I don't think I can handle being deprived of my morning. And I said to him, 2 weeks before Ramadan, start to wean off yourself with the coffee. And so he said, yeah, that's a good idea. Begins a new Muslim, taking the challenge. All of us should not be proud of ourselves with that. But then there are some of us who will feel that, you know, that's not enough. And then all of us can't fast. Some of us may actually be sick. We might have elderly people. And so Allah says, okay, here's another choice. There's something called sadaqah that you can partake of. Jibreel said that the Prophet spent more in Ramadan than any other month. And so Ramadan is a month of sadaqah also. When you spend for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah changes His relationship with you. Allah said, وَمَنْ أَعْطَى وَاتَّقَى وَصَدَّقَ بِالْحُسْنَى فَسَوْفَ يُؤْتِيهِ أَجْرًا عَظِيمًا. That who have taqwa and spend for Allah, Allah says all the things which was hard for you to do before, I'm going to make them easy for you. I will ease your path to easiness for you. I'll make them happen. So when you begin to spend, Allah changes the way He's with you. He'll make things that were difficult to you suddenly open doors, and you will see things happen. Secondly, when you spend, someone benefits from that which you have given. Thirdly, Allah said, I will return to you whatever you have spent. I will not allow you to become a pauper as a result of that. For a shaitan, when you go to spend, shaitan says you're going to become poor. Allah says, I will return that. Also, when you spend, Allah will bless that action. The most reward that is given in our deed for actions is in the actions. مثل الذين ينفقون أموالهم في سبيل الله كمثل حبة أنبتت سبع سنابل. The ayah continues. When you spend it like 700 times. والله يضاعف لمن يشاء. Allah says, I can magnify, increase that even more. And so here you have the second choice, to spend. And when you spend it, it frees you from greed. It frees you from the attachment of the dunya. It purifies your wealth. And it is is protected and it remains on Yom Kiyamah when you need that. So you have that to do. So don't forget to spend. And among the best ways to spend is on the poor. On those who are fasting. When you spend to feed people who are fasting, Allah says, I will give you the reward of that person's fast without depriving their reward. And you get what you, all the benefits of giving as well. And so we have that choice. We have another choice. If you can't spend, you don't have money. So your sadaqa is smiling at people and doing whatever good deeds from your skill set that you may have. You don't have to. Sadaqa is not just about money. Third choice. شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن. Allah introduces the month of Ramadan as the month of Quran. هُدًى لِلنَّاسِ وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِنَ الْهُدَى وَالْفُرْقَانِ. And reintroduces the Quran to the Sahaba who already knew the Quran. It says it is guidance for humanity. إِنَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ يَهْدِي لِلَّذِي أَهُوَ. This Quran guides to that which is straight. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says this month is truly about Quran. It was revealed in this month. And so, in this month, you must develop a relationship with the Quran. No matter what your level is, level one, I don't know to read Arabic. I don't know to recite the Quran. Then you must engage with the Quran by reading it in English. You can't just say, well, I have a free pass. I don't know to recite in Arabic, so read it in English. And make a decision to read the whole book for the month. If Urdu is your language, read it in Urdu. Whatever is your first language that you're comfortable with, and you can't read it in Arabic, read it in your mother language. If you can recite the Quran, don't chicken out. Make a decision to read a portion every single day of Ramadan. Some people, they finish the whole book for the month. They take one juz every day and they recite. If that's your level, you do so. But for some, this might be too much. So you say, you know what, every day I'm going to read 10 verses. And you consistently do it. But you've got to connect with the Quran during this month. For truly the Quran will intercede to Allah also on our behalf. And Allah, the hadith tells us that when you recite the Quran, every letter of the Quran that you recite, not every word, an alif, lam, means three letters. You get a reward that Allah multiplies tenfold. So you get 10 blessings for every letter of the Quran that you recite. If you memorize the Quran as much as you can, you will get an opportunity to recite in paradise, and as you recite as much as you know, you will rise in paradise until you finish all that you know, and that will be your position. The best of you is he who learns the Quran and teaches it. So the Quran is really special and important. That's an important buffet choice item that you must select. And so know that our minimalist postures, I just fast and that's it. You've got to engage with the Quran this month in some form or the other. Every day you must touch it. Open it. Have a schedule. I don't care how busy you are. There's nothing more important in your life than doing this. We have a choice also of Salah. In this month of Ramadan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided many, many opportunities for us to pray extra prayer and to connect with Him. When you pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's the closest point. When you put your head up to sajda, it is the closest moment that you are to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Salatan alif wa salam protects you from the shaitan. It protects you from wickedness and evil things. The salah is your mi'raj al-mu'mineen. It is the ascension of the believers. And so this month we get to partake of the Taraweeh and all the other ibadah. So most important during this month, at least pray the 5 daily salat. If you are at that level, make sure the minimum accepted, allowable position you want to take is to pray the fard of every, of all 5 salat. And then you go up levels and levels. Try to do more and more for the sake of Allah. Don't adopt the posture of not praying. The prayer of the 5 daily salah is more important than the Taraweeh. This is the one that is compulsory. that Allah says you must do. And so during Ramadan, really ask Allah to help me to do this. I know many Muslims, we struggle with this. This thing of getting up so early, having to pray at these inconvenient times during the day. You know, it's really hard for the weak believer to be able to grapple with this on a daily basis. And every day you gotta repeat this. Ask Allah to strengthen your heart to do that. It's going to be tough unless you have, you know, وَاسْتَعِينُ بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ إِنَّهَا لَكَبِيرَةٌ إِلَّا عَلَى الْخَاشِعِينَ. That you seek help with salah and patience, but it will be difficult if the heart is not ready. It's not humble, it's not submissive. Doesn't have enough of faith in there to drive you to make those prayers. So select that during this month. There's also a choice which many of us don't choose. It's called muhasabah. And that is self-introspection. This is the moment when you want to take some time away from the hustle and bustle of the world and really talk to yourself and talk to Allah and ask yourself, how is my life? How am I doing? I wonder how many years more I have left on the planet. Put a number. Make a desire that you want. Oh Allah, I want to be maybe live to 90 or 100. Whatever number you put, I want to live to 130. Put a number and then ask yourself, how am I going to live this? What am I doing? Am I really doing the things that will put me in a good shape to meet Allah? But sometimes we get involved, al-haqu muttakathir hatta zurtumul maqabir. We get so busy in the bustle of life that before you know it, you die. We didn't even get a memo saying, you know, you're supposed to be, we're coming for you. The angel of death doesn't really send you a memo. I said, okay, you know, your appointment is 2 weeks from now, so get ready. You sleep one night and you wake up the next day. And so you've got to have a moment with yourself to say, how am I doing with my life, my relationships? How am I connected to Allah? Am I getting myself so busy with priorities other than what is important for me in my grave and on the day that I am going there for sure? We're all going there. Take some time to really talk to yourself and ask yourself. And if you find that you're not doing so well, Allah is the one that gives people second and third chances. At-Tawwab, Ar-Rahim. Allah says, come to me. Don't worry. No matter how bad your situation is, Allah will embrace you and say, you want to make a new start? You want to begin again? You want to begin from today? No problem. Ya ibadi tuqtikuna billayl wa nahara wa anfir zunuba jami'a fastaghfiruni aghfir lakum. Allah says, oh my servants, let me tell you something. News. You people commit sins by day and by night. But good news, I, Allah, forgive all sins. So here's what you do. You seek forgiveness from me, and I will take care of you. I will handle your case. I will give you a next chance. So don't become depressed and worried about what your past is. Become excited about the decision you will make now, moving forward. Don't sit and worry about what wrongs have done in the past. Forgive yourself, ask Allah to forgive you, leave that aside, and decide from today on what kind of believer I want to become for the few years that I have left, however time. That is what Ramadan is supposed to do to us, to make and produce in us that. When you begin to do that, that is what taqwa means. Allah mentioned about taqwa about 200 times before. Try to get us to really connect and understand that this is what is priority. And so, during this month of Ramadan, understand that you and I are the ones that Allah is expected to solve the problems of the world. This month is to help us to become equipped and proficient and magnificent and capable and committed to that enterprise. Allah has given this month to produce in us and to bring out the best of who we are and to help us to become this special champion, that after Ramadan we can go out there and champion all the causes that humanity is looking for solutions for. We have the solution. We need to go out there and champion the causes. And so I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to have the most magnificent Ramadan we've ever had. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not to make it our last. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to let us approach it with an idea of grabbing as much as we can from the month. Exhaust yourself. This is not the month to sleep too much. Don't look for your sleep. This is not the month to start quarreling with people you are quarreling all year round. Ignore them. Focus on your soul. Focus on ourselves. You know, and work hard during this month so that we can reap those beautiful rewards that Allah has prepared for us.
الحمد لله رب العالمين وسيرة طيبة مباركة فيك ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده ونشهد أن محمدا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. Oh Lord, we raise our hands and we ask you to accept from us and to inspire our hearts to become committed to your cause. Oh Allah, help us to recognize you. Oh Allah, help us to serve you. Oh Allah, help us to worship you. Oh Allah, help us to trust you. Do you know best for us? And oh Allah, guide our steps and our hearts to be able to do what is right. Oh Allah, we ask you to protect those who are suffering in every part of the world. The believers, give them hope, give them patience. Remove fear from their hearts and allow them to trust in your wisdom as well. Oh Allah, we ask you to help those who are sick among us to be healthy again. Oh Allah, we ask you to allow us to be able to survive and to benefit from this glorious month of Ramadan. Oh Allah, we ask you to always keep us within your grace and your mercy. Help us to be able to raise our hands often and to ask from you whenever we mess up or make mistakes. In the love of Allah, the Azza wa Jalla, the Qurba, the Yadhan, the Fahsha'i,